I believe God's going to fill you up today. Filling, He loves to fill us. So listen, if you want more, then run after Him, amen? And so the altars are open. Come on, step out and just kind of worship the Lord with all you got. We bless you today with what God has, and we love you in Jesus' name. Father, bless the service. Bless the prayer team. Father God, bless the musicians today. Holy Spirit, come. Father, we love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
You made me scream.
centering this passion in my soul. I will dance, I will sing to be mad for my King.
Oh, For your pleasure, I am saved. move your heart, God, to give you all I have. I wanna bless your name. To worship you, I live. To worship you, I live to worship you. And to worship you, I live. To worship you, I live to worship you. I live to worship you. To worship you, I live. To worship you, I live to worship you. before your throne of grace. Here we are, God. Come before your mercy seat. Here we are, God. Come before your throne of grace. Here we are, God. Come before your mercy seat. I can see the lightning. I can feel the thunder. I can hear the voices proceeding from your throne. And I can see the lightning. I can feel the thunder. I can hear the voices proceeding from your throne. 24 elders bowing low, they're casting down their crowns of gold. The four living creatures crying out day and night, night and day. And only one word comes to mind. There's only one word to describe. And only one word comes to mind. There's only one word to describe. Holy, holy, yeah. Lord God Almighty. To Jesus, we say, holy, 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 yeah. Lord God Almighty, oh, holy, yeah. Holy, yeah. Lord God Almighty.
There's only one way.
are holy. Oh, oh, there is no one like you, God.
What are you gonna do with the God? want to invite you just to begin to start singing in the Spirit. Come on, there's such an atmosphere of heaven in this house this morning. And it says in 2 Chronicles chapter 5, when they came together as one with one voice in praise and honor and thanking God, it says a cloud of glory came and filled that place where they could no longer minister. In Ephesians 5:18, when it talks about the fruit of being filled with the Spirit, it's speaking to one another in psalms, in spiritual songs, in hymns, giving thanks to God. And see, one of the evidence of being filled with the Spirit is what we're speaking, what we're releasing into the atmosphere. And so I just want to make room right now for Holy Spirit as He gives you utterance. Just begin to start singing in the Spirit. Begin to, I'm telling you, that's when we become, there's an as one voice to where the Spirit is singing the song of the Lord through you over this house and throughout this city and across this state. Come on, just begin to release your voice. Come on, just by faith right now, just begin to sing out in the Spirit. This may be new for you, but I'm telling you, just if you'll begin to engage it by faith, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, if you'll begin to give Him your voice, He'll begin to release His song through your lips. He'll begin to release His words through your mouth. One of the ministries of the Holy Spirit in Ephesians chapter 1 is to begin to release to us a spirit of wisdom and revelation. It's understanding, it's to see and to say the hope of God's calling in our life and the glorious riches of God in one another. It says His inheritance in the saints. It doesn't say a saint, it says all of us coming together as one. And it says in this place we would know the exceeding greatness of His power toward us according to the working of His power in us. And so can we do this as we transition? Just find somebody right now, and with their permission, just place your hand on them. And just begin to start releasing the Holy Spirit. I want to tell you, the power is not in your words, it's not in your prayers, it's in your belief, amen? And so just begin to start releasing that atmosphere. Just start giving away God right now in the name of Jesus. Have God will give in Jesus' name. And for those watching online, right now, we just speak healing to your body right now. Father, even Ricky Tucker, Father, right now, Lord, right now, we take authority over that spirit of cancer in Jesus' name. And Father, in the name of Jesus, we declare not only complete healing and remission, but redemption as well, the work of restoration in his body. And for those who are watching right now, we take authority over every sickness, over every infirmity, over every affliction in this place, and for those connected to this house. And we declare in the name of Jesus, be healed, be whole. Right now, in the name of Jesus, we call for miracles to be released. God, we thank you for opening deaf ears. God, we thank you for causing blind eyes to see. God, we thank you for the lame beginning to walk again. God, we thank you, Lord, that even the dead would be raised in Jesus' name. We bless your name, Lord Jesus. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you're doing. Shondoramondo, Kandorebata, Shekoramondo, Shondoremando, Shandoremandai, Kondorebaba, Shekondoramondo. Come on, like a river, like a river. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, we invite your ministry. We welcome the presence of God and the power of God and the person of God in this house. In Jesus' name, we make room for you, Holy Spirit. We make room for you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Hey, Candace, come on up here. I want to pray for you. While everybody else is praying, my attention, my heart was just drawn to you during worship. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Jesus, we bless you. Holy Spirit, we love you. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. We love that when you come into the room, Lord, Holy Spirit, you say that you glorify Jesus. And so, Lord, this morning, we invite you, Holy Spirit, to come and glorify the King of Kings, to come and lift up the Lord of Lords, to come and make known the Prince of Peace in each and every heart in this place. Holy Spirit, we make room this morning for you to glorify Jesus. Lord, for us, through us, to us, God, we want all that you have this morning. Lord, we just remove the limits and the expectations we've placed on you of what is and what isn't God. And we just say, Lord, we want God. We want you, Holy Spirit. We want you, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you that you're not like our natural daddies, but you're a good father. God, I thank you, Lord, that you don't cause us to relate to you based on where we've been. But you call us to relate to you based on who you are. And you're a good father. And we love you today. In Jesus' name. Jesus, we love you. Jesus, we worship you. Jesus, we give you our everything today. As soon as I said that, Jesus, I give you. We give you our everything. I saw him receiving what we gave. And a lot of times we can talk about giving God everything in terms of our time and our giving and our treasure, all those things. But that wasn't it. I saw the Lord, I saw as a 1 Peter chapter 5 when he says, humble yourself and in due time, I'll exalt you. And he tells us how to humble ourselves. He said, by casting your care on me because I care for you. And I just feel like that there are burdens that can be cast right now that he'll receive, he'll take, and he'll take it so far from your life, even the thought won't be an option. And so whatever you're given this morning, I tell you the name of Jesus, he's receiving. And so you can give it to him right now. Anything that's been weighing on you, anything that you're just not called to carry, it may not even be a burden. It could be like Ashton spoke about on Wednesday night, the lies of life, things that were spoken over you or things that were not said that created a concept of inadequacy in your life. Just give those things to him right now. Because as we give him what we've been holding on to and our strength, he'll release to us what he's been holding together by his. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Well, speaking of God, the Lord receiving what we give, he said, let the children come to me. So let's go ahead and release the kids right now. Come on down, King's Kids. If you're 12 and under, come on down. We've got an amazing day planned for you. Look at these wonderful sons and daughters. Aren't they amazing? And we've, not only do we have the new Children's Sanctuary and, of course, the Perrys who were with us last week moving down the first week of June, but also we have a new system that we're going to be incorporating with the kids here in a few weeks. Has anybody ever heard of something called Kid Check? Okay? It's awesome. Okay? And you can go to, is it kidcheck.org?
I can't remember if it's .org or .com.
Google Kid Check, not right now, but later if you have a parent, if you have a child, okay? And because what we're going to be doing, you'll be able to go on and create an online profile for your kid, for your child. It's going to be great. It's going to give us not only more security options, but also more ability for communication between our children's pastors and their parents. It's going to be great. Every parent is going to get, you know, like those little magnetic strips you get for the gym. You're going to get one of those for King's Kids, to where you just go scan it, and then of course you know the children will be checked in, and they can only be checked out by you. How many of you know we want to provide a safe environment for our kids? Amen. And so it's something that we've really gone in and invested in the name of your children and providing the best system to be able to receive and steward the blessing that is your sons and daughters. And so you can go to Kid Check, like I said, learn a little bit more about it. We'll have the system set up either this week or next week to where you can go online, create all your profiles. It's great. Like if there's an issue with a child, it sends an automatic text to your phone instead of somebody bringing the baby to you, you know, those kind of things. And so it's just going to be awesome. And how many of you are excited about new things? How many are excited about partnering practically with the prophetic? And so if God says he's going to send a lot more young families with small children, with that prophetic word, there's also practical responsibility. Amen? And so we're taking those practical steps. But let's go ahead and stretch our hands forward to these amazing sons and daughters of the King. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for what you're going to do in and through their lives today. God, we thank you that you're awakening their hearts to identity. You're awakening in their hearts to who they are because of who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys have an awesome morning with Miss Tina and Miss Hannah. Awesome, awesome. You're awesome, buddy. Come on now. And also, I want to welcome, if anybody's here for the very first time today, if this is your first time at Kingsway Church, raise your hand. We've got a gift we want to give you. Awesome, awesome, awesome. What's your name? Yeah. Grenda? Drenda, welcome. Where are you from? Awesome. We're so glad that you're here. I love your heart of worship. My spirit was really bearing witness with you in worship. I could feel that. How many of you know sometimes you can actually feel, you know, you can feel senses of agreement. You can actually discern a brother or sister in Christ. How many of you know that? Jeff and I, we were at Logan Steakhouse this week having a lunch meet with somebody, and then we had a lady who was a bus driver, 26 years. She was eating over near us, walked out with her to go, came back in. She said, "I knew y'all were believers. I could feel the light coming off of you." And she just told us her whole story, needed some prayer on things, and needed some ministry. And I'm telling you, people know your light sometimes greater than you do because they see his shining in and through your life. Amen? The guys behind right there, what's your names? Where are you from? Blake, what part of Mississippi? Corinth. Awesome. The Watleys are from Mississippi, Cleveland area. Yes, sir. What's your name? Where are you from? Emery from Fultondale. Awesome. We're glad that you're here. And Emery, you look familiar to me. I'm not sure if we met before, but you look familiar. Could just be in the spirit. Amen. Anybody else here for the very first time? Anybody else? Awesome. We had a couple birthdays this week. Of course, Beverly and Miss Mary. Miss Mary's in the nursery. They had a birthday yesterday. Can we thank the Lord for Beverly and Miss Mary? Tomorrow is Gio's birthday. Everybody just, that camera right there, he's back there directing in the video suite. Everybody just waved to Gio. Happy birthday, Gio! And so when he got in the director suite this morning, it was all filled up with balloons and just fun stuff. And also, I saw Mick earlier, but is Marcia here? She's on her way. Well, listen, I've got a word for you guys that I'll save for the 11 o'clock service then about your anniversary. Mick and Marcia also celebrated their 43rd anniversary. Can we thank the Lord for that? Any other birthdays or anniversaries this week? Josh? Michelle? Hey, happy birthday, girl. You were trying to hide it back there. Oh, anniversary? I'm sorry. Hey, listen, cake and more cake, you know? I'm always looking for a reason to celebrate. Amen. Well, awesome. Well, happy anniversary, you guys. And listen, come on now. Getting a new house, what a way to celebrate an anniversary. And we're so glad that you're here this morning. And I'm going to invite, where's Amy Skye? Oh, there she is. Come on up, Amy. Amy's going to tell us about some practical opportunities to serve this week in our food distribution.
Morning, everyone. Good morning. So tomorrow we are going to be doing food prep for our food distribution on Tuesday. So if you would like to volunteer and be a part of that, if you could meet at the church at 10, we will be putting out food, getting everything all ready for food distribution on Tuesday. And Tuesday is such a wonderful thing. We're doing our food distribution to our community. It's been growing. We've been just seeing, as Pastor Jason's been sharing, so many, most of the people I think have been saved, now filled with the Holy Spirit, and now they're getting water baptized. This is so awesome. We've been seeing so many healings and miracles happening in that service. So Tuesday at 8:30, we're going to be doing our food distribution. So if you could be here by 8:30, we have time. We have a meeting, we have prayer, and then we open the doors for our community to come in and get free food. So you're welcome to join us for that too. And also, I am looking for some help in our clothing closet. Our King's clothing closet is just going amazing, and so I do need someone. We've gotten some clothes, so we need someone to help hang clothes, and then if I could just have one person one day a week who can actually maybe dedicate like 2 hours, volunteer maybe 2 hours, I can get lots of people coming in to get free clothes. So if you're interested in that, you can see me in the Connect Center.
Amen. How many of you here have served in our food ministry or clothing ministry? Isn't that awesome? Oh, man, just such a great time in the Lord. And again, the Lord's moving in such an amazing way. And we're believing for the Lord to send just a fresh crop of folks as well, just that are needing to encounter the goodness of God. Amen? And because it's the goodness of God that causes us to think different, to live different, and to see different. Amen? And we're going to be talking today, continuing. Well, we may. We'll just see what happens. There's so much in my heart. But one of the things is we're wanting to remove our limits off of an unlimited God. How many of you ever know that sometimes you can put your limits on what he wants to do? Amen? See, the Spirit's been given without measure, but oftentimes we're limited in what we receive and release. And there's three ways, of course, that we limit the Lord in what we believe, what we see, and what we say. But if we begin to remove those limits off of what we believe, see, and say, I believe we'll begin to see God move in an Ephesians 3:20 way in and through our city. Amen? And that brings me, Mick and Marcia, is Marcia back now? Mick and Marcia, come on down here. And Mick and Marcia, again, you know, Marcia was out there probably just doing the Lord's work in the Connect Cafe, bless God. And when I saw yesterday on Facebook that you guys had celebrated your 43rd anniversary, the Lord said that it was a word and that this is your Isaiah 43 year. And so when he said that, of course, the scripture that always comes up in our hearts is in verse 18, do not call to mind the former things, nor even consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. And even as great as the great moments have been, you haven't seen anything yet. It's about to be beyond what you asked, thought, or even dreamed possible. Amen. Yes. And listen, out of that, the whole Isaiah 43, I felt was a word to you guys. The Lord highlighted a couple different verses to me that I just wanted to speak into you guys. And I'm telling you, by the way, you can catch a prophecy. How many of you know that? When you begin to rejoice with those who rejoice, you actually become a landing strip for the promises of God in your life as well. But it says, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. Since you are precious in my sight, you have been honored and I have loved you. Therefore, I will give men for you and people for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not keep them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. And one of the things that I really felt like God was giving you guys a fresh level of authority in is where you've been faithful to intercede for sons and daughters of other mothers and fathers. God's going to release not just a movement of God in your family, but I saw God positioning you like Nehemiah, when Nehemiah would position different families at different parts of the wall. And you guys have a grace and authority as it relates to restoration in families and seeing the prodigals begin to turn in their tracks and come home. Because in verse 7 it says, for everyone who is called by my name, who I have created for my glory, I have formed him, yes, I have made him. And I saw the Lord giving you guys an insight and understanding to begin to awaken identity to who people are called to be. And the fact that so much of what they walked in was never what God had planned, but it's what God used to prepare them for the fullness of his plan. It says, let all the nations be gathered together and let the peoples be assembled. Who among them can declare this and show us the former things? Let them bring out their witness that they may be justified, or let them hear and say it is truth. Going down to verse 12, halfway through, it says, therefore, you are my witnesses. And I felt like the Lord is saying this, that you are his witnesses, says the Lord, I am God. Indeed, before this day, I am he, and there is no one who can deliver out of my hand. I work, and who will reverse it? And of course, 18 and 19 says, do not remember the former things. And I feel a strong admonition on that. Like, it's awesome to be thankful for what God has done, but even Paul said, one thing I'm doing is I'm forgetting. He said, I'm not where I'm going, but one thing that's helping me get there is forgetting everything that's behind and reaching forward. And I feel like even what been good would actually limit you from laying hold of what is God. If you begin to hold in memory what he's done in times past, there's a way to be thankful for who he is without setting up a wrong memorial in our heart to what he's done. But it says, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now, can we say now? Say now. Let's say this again. Come on, everybody to your feet. Let's prophesy everyone together. Can we do that? And here I'm going to give you the prophecy in advance. So we can all say it in advance, okay? Now it shall spring forth. Okay, so on the count of three, everybody stretch your hands out. Ready? Now it shall spring forth. 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 Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Verse 25 and 26 says, I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my name's sake, and I will not remember your sins. Put me in remembrance and let us contend together. State your case that you may be acquitted. And I saw there being access and entrance into the courts, like a Zechariah 3, to walk among those in heavenly places and to be given the authority to keep the charge of God's court and to be a verbal executor of justice. It's okay. To be a verbal executor of justice to establish righteousness in the land. Amen. Can we thank the Lord for Mike and Marcia? Jesus. And I know I threw you guys off because I said on the count of three, but you followed well. Amen. I love you guys. And I felt like there was a corporate release on that word, because I want to tell you, as you prophesied over them, now it shall spring forth. Guess what? Your seeds are about to sprout. Come on, your seeds are about to sprout. You know why? Because it's time. It's time. It's time. It's time. It's time. It's your time. It's Alabama's time. Amen. It's time. Isn't it, Ashton? You did such a great job Wednesday night. I'm so proud of you. So awesome. And Matt, just incredible. Matt, what are we doing this Wednesday? Game Changers. Come on. We had 1 week. It was a week of release. Last week it was a week of superheroes. This week is a week of Game Changers. So if you need a rolling of the tide in your life, if you need to see a reversal of what's happening in your world, don't miss this Wednesday night with our School of Spirit. It's going to be an amazing time. It's time. Did I mention that? It's time. And Lord, what do you want to do? I'm going to tell you a little bit about why it's time. And in the midst of this, we're going to just receive our offering in the spirit of this. And then I'm going to declare Deuteronomy 28 blessings over your life. Amen? And so you can begin to prepare your offering. If you're making out checks to Kingsway Church, if you want to get by either, if you're making out checks, just make them out to Kingsway Church. If you want to get by cash or credit card, there's envelopes and seat pocket in front of you. Some folks prefer to give online. I know those who are watching this morning, there's a green give online button right there beneath your screen. And we have faithful, not just viewers, but members of this house. How many of you know one of the ways that you communicate your heart commitment is through your treasure? Amen? Because where your treasure is, your heart is also. And there's people all around the world that are partnered with what God is doing right here in Birmingham, Alabama, and are committed to what God has promised in this place to come to pass. But it's time. In fact, I'd encourage you, write that on your offering envelope as a declaration. It's time. Write it in the middle of your check. It's time. Because we're going to make a declaration today. We're going to make a demand on where we are and where God's brought us from, but also what he's promised to bring us into. Three scriptures that were stirring in my heart when I was thinking about it's time. And these are two words that have just been ruminating in my heart for about 3 weeks. One, Galatians 6:9 says, let us. It doesn't say let you, it means let us. You know what that tells me? That sometimes we got to encourage one another. Anybody ever felt weary? And then all of a sudden you get a call from the right person at the right time that was like strength to your soul. That said, hey, come on, man, I love you. Begin to thank God for what he's doing and not what he's not. See, it says, let us not grow weary. Because we're not called to fight this thing alone. You're not just some lone finger. We're the body. Amen? Let us not. In fact, let's declare this together. Let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season, we shall reap if we do not lose heart, if we faint not. And Isaiah 40 tells us that when we wait upon the Lord, we will walk and not faint. We will run. Amen? Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 12 says, the Lord. Come on, let's say this together. She's going to put it on the screen for us. Deuteronomy 28, 12. If you already have your offering prepared, feel free to stand up. Exercise that diaphragm. Come on now. Deuteronomy 28, 12 says, the Lord will open to you. Let's declare this. The Lord's going to open to me. Right? The Lord will open to me his good treasure, the heavens, to give the rain to my land in its season. Let's do that and say Birmingham. Let's do that and say Alabama. Let's do that and say this nation. The Lord will open to us his good treasure, the heavens, to give rain to Birmingham, to give rain to Irondale, to give rain to Alabama, to give rain to this nation, that the seeds of righteousness will now spring forth. And to bless the work of our hands, we will lend to nations, and we shall not borrow. God is breaking debt off of you. God is breaking debt off of this house. I'm telling you, I'm more resolved than ever to even get the mortgage of this place paid off. I'm telling you, God is breaking debt off of his body. He's breaking debt off of your hand. I'm telling you, he's breaking everything that is the fruit of the curse off of your life. Isaiah 60, verse 22, the last verse of one of the greatest logos prophetic promises that has ever been given to the Arise and Shine Company is this. In Isaiah 60, verse 22, Laura, if you can put it up there, it says, a little one shall become a thousand. See, that's why right now the government's trying to attack our little ones, because even the devil knows their potential. But I'm telling you, it's time to let our voice be heard, to reach out, to contact elected officials, to call the schools and say, we're not going to allow this to happen. We're not going to allow this to happen. Why? Because a little one will become a thousand. And there's increase and multiplication upon your seed. Psalm 115, 14 and 15 says the Lord would cause you and your children to increase. A little one shall become a thousand, and a small one a strong nation. But here's what I want you to hear, see. I, the Lord, will hasten it in its time. You know what that tells me? There was a time stamp on Isaiah 60. And we've never been in a time or season in this earth like we are now. And I'm telling you, if it's not the time, I don't know what could be the time. Now is the time. If not now, then when? If not here, then where? If not you, then who? Come on, let's give to the Lord this morning.
I open up to you. This love that makes me new. Oh, may my heart be sweet. This love that carries me from the head to the heart. You take me on a journey of letting go, of getting lost in you. From the head to the heart. Take me on a journey of letting go, of getting lost in you. My heart is open wide. We'll receive your life. You give me faith like a child. In you my heart rests wide. 'Cause there's no shame in looking like a fool when I give you what I gave you to take a hold. Looking like a fool when I give you
what I can't keep.
Take hold of. One more time. And there's no shame in looking like a fool when I give you
what I can't keep. Take hold of you.
Amen. Pastor Smoke this morning, he said something about our debt. Holy Spirit quickened that back to my heart, because last night, that was on my heart. He put that in my heart that this is a month we need to ask big prayers. Not man prayers, God prayers. That means something that man can't do it. God can. So over this house today, I want to decree and declare that this place be debt free.
Come on.
Debt free in this year.
Come on. Come on.
We're in a month of Issachar, men who knew the times. And it's time.
Come on.
It's time for us to be debt free, set free. That
every
we
one
might
of you.
Move
come on.
Forward in what Birmingham needs, what the state of Alabama needs. We are a hub. We are a starting point, a well that's bubbling up. So I decree and declare on this place we are debt free. I don't know how, but I know the one who can. In Jesus' name, I declare that.
Come on, if you listen, if you need that in your life too, come on, just give the Lord a shout of praise right now. Come on, hallelujah! 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 And also, I have a word for Jeff's daughter and fiance. What are your names? Haley? What is it? Kyle and Haley. I don't know why I can't. Come on. Kyle and Haley. Everybody say, hi, Kyle and Haley. And right then, as I was standing over there, I looked out and I saw written over you, Kyle, the name Gideon. And Gideon was a mighty man. He was a warrior. His name meant warrior, but he had actually been in a place of hiding to where his strength had not yet been known. And he looked to the Lord. He said, come on, where's the mighty works of God that I heard about? In other words, I want the real thing. I want a demonstration of who God is and not just stories about him. And the Lord has seen your heart to say, I want the real thing and not just some idea or concept. And I saw the Lord bringing you out of that wine press and beginning to put you into the field in a brand new place, but beginning to cause you to walk in the fullness of that mighty warrior name. And also, Haley, I really felt like the Lord is saying, like, this is a new start, not just for you, but for your entire family. A lot of what you've seen in life and marriage and stuff like that in times past is not going to go into your future. So in other words, your past will not influence your present, and your present will not even be compared to where God is taking you. I actually saw that there is a season of redemption upon you both in the name of Jesus, like what I said to Mick and Marcia about don't even call to mind how you guys grew up and what you grew up with. God's going to do something so new and so radical in your heart. It's going to give hope to the whole family that brings restoration even to family members that you thought were hopeless in Jesus' name. Can we thank the Lord for Kyle and Haley? Thank you, Jesus. Also, those of you who are visiting, you can fill out those Connect cards. Take them to the Connect Cafe afterwards and see Amy. She'll be the one out there with the tan, right, Amy? Where'd she go? All right. So anyway, so she'll be out there. She's got those MP3 cards that she wants to give you as well. And wasn't worship great? Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And we had an amazing time this past Thursday. We took our team up to Richard and Ellen's Lake House River Rest, and which that's a word right there, and just had an amazing time of strategic planning and just getting some great downloads from the Lord on what this next year, the rest of 2016 and 17, are supposed to look like for Kingsway Church. And so your prayers are answered, and they're continue to be answered as God continues to show us the how of the what. Amen? See, we're all clear on why we do what we do, and we're all clear on what we're called to do, and a lot of times it's that in-between place called how that we need a little help. Amen? But how many of you are thankful that one of the names for Holy Spirit is Helper? Amen? And so he really has given us some great wisdom, insight, and understanding. And one of the things that we did that was just so powerful was we looked back at this last year. You know, and how many of you know, sometimes you can become so busy in the midst of where you are, you almost don't even recognize what God has done. But then we sat around and we looked at, okay, what has the Lord led us to do that has really worked amazing and brought great life to people and to our congregation and to our city? And it was like six or eight of those like big old like easel pages. I mean, just, and Jeff was writing, so it was small type, and I mean, just getting it. And then we're like, well, what could we have done, you know, better? And honestly, like, we spent time and time. We could only come up with really four things that we as a church could have done a little bit differently or a little bit better and maybe had better results. And to me, that was just such an admonishment of you guys and this house and our willingness. Because how many of you know, listen, if we lean on our own understanding, we'll get what we had. But if we can acknowledge the Lord and see him and say yes to what he asks us to do, we'll get what he wants to give. And I'm telling you, that's what we have been positioned for as a people and as a congregation and as one body. Why? Because it's time. Say it's time. It feels good, doesn't it? Do you believe it? Awesome. If you believe it, you see it, and you say it, things will change. Amen? You know, I had a friend text me last night. He said, hey, I saw that you guys are celebrating Pentecost tomorrow. And I said, yeah. He said, so y'all are working off the Catholic calendar, not the Hebrew calendar. I said, well, any excuse we have to celebrate Pentecost, we're going to lay hold of it. And I said, I'm just going to be honest. We celebrate Pentecost every Sunday at Kingsway Church. We're always believing for an outpouring. We're always believing for a suddenly of God, that suddenly a sound will begin to fill this place and the Holy Spirit will be poured out without measure. Amen? And see, because at first when I saw it, because honestly I was talking to some folks that were having Pentecost gatherings, and I told Tina, I said, man, Pentecost snuck up on me. Typically I'm real good about this stuff and keeping everything kind of aligned in the calendar. And so my heart was just excited for what God wanted to do today. So I put it on Facebook. And so when he shot me this text, I heard this little voice going, well, you better go ahead and take that down because you don't want to offend anybody that's working off the Hebrew calendar. And I'm real good at ignoring that voice, by the way. And I really felt like the Lord said, why don't you believe for a double Pentecost? And so I text back. I said, you wait till June. We're going to have it both times. Because I believe that in the new covenant, Pentecost isn't about a day or a season, but it's about the breath we've been given, and we wake up every day and get to live a life fully filled with Holy Spirit. But there's a difference between being Spirit-filled and Spirit-led. There's a lot of shakarabandais that are outside of the will of God. I'm just saying. Romans 8:14 says, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they're the sons of God. Amen? And so we don't want to just be filled. We want to be filled and to follow. To be filled by the Spirit and to follow the Spirit in all that we say and do. Amen? I'm going to go off script. Turn to John chapter 11. Turn to John chapter 11. And I'm attempting to preach the same message we thought we were going to do last week. And if the Lord just wants us to park in this place of removing our limits for a while, I'm good with that. Because I don't want to leave any rock unturned when it comes to the ways that I've limited the Lord in my life. I want to see all limits removed off of me, off of you, and off of us, and off of this city. Amen? And we're not going to allow the distractions of the day to keep us at bay. We're not going to allow what the enemy would want to bring discouragement to our heart and outside influences to keep us from believing as God believes, seeing as God sees, and saying as God says. Because those are the three main areas that we limit an unlimited God in what we believe, what we see, and what we say. But turn to John chapter 11. You're already there. I'm going to catch up with you. I went to pick up my truck on Wednesday afternoon. And those of you who don't know, you know, my baby, you know, she got a little black eye. And that's okay. And she's back better than ever. And they're going to do even more to it next week. And so how many of you hate it when you get in a car accident? How many of you hate it when it's not your fault? How many of you hate driving a compact car? Come on now. Jesus, take the wheel. It's like Chris Salter when he said he couldn't do minivans. I don't do compacts. I've got roller skates bigger than an Altima, amen? Just kidding. You don't want to see me on roller skates. But Jeff, on the other hand, can shoot the duck like nobody's business. Limbo King over here. And so how many of you know vehicles speak of ministries? Well, when I got there, and instantly, just the way my eye is, in fact, Bob Weiner was here with us on Friday, just kind of looking at what we're doing, and so we were walking around with Dee and Amy, and I would see something, and Bob would see something, and so Dee was like, man, we got to get you guys, like, apart. Like, he was seeing things that need to be done, I was seeing things, and Bob told Dee, he said, no, he said, that's the apostolic. He said, it's not seeing what's wrong, it's seeing what can be done to be better. Amen? And so as soon as I pulled in to there, as soon as Dee brought me to the car, I look over, and all of a sudden I see the fenders actually hanging over the bumper about an inch. It's like, that ain't gonna do. You know, I'm seeing things that are out of alignment. How many of you know some things that can be just out of alignment in a small way, but it makes a big difference. And see, once you see something that just could be better, sometimes that's all you can see. Anybody with me? Yeah. Is anybody else? First step's admitting you're OCD. Right? No, I'm just kidding. No, I'm just kidding. Listen, I learned from the best. Nana can shine the bronze right off a doorknob. Bam. But I pulled in and I said, wait a minute. I said, the Lord's doing something and my truck's not done yet. And I didn't even say anything to the people inside, but I did notice something. There was this hanging on my mirror. It was my claim check, and there's actually the other claim check fell off this morning as I was getting out of the car. It's in my cup holder, and I had the name of the person who had checked me in. Her name was Mary. It had my name, and then it had some other numbers. But 121 really spoke to me. Why? Because 11. See, 11 times 11 is 121. And see, oftentimes the Lord will speak to us through whatever we, God will get his word to you and through you by whatever means necessary. And when I saw it, Steve, I said, 121 gigawatts, bless God, we've got more than enough. Y'all remember Back to the Future? Come on, the flux capacitor. And so all of a sudden, the Lord just started speaking to me because the number 1111 means a couple different things. Isaiah 1111 means it's second chances. It's all about the people of Israel being brought back to the land that God had promised and appointed them to be. And how many of you know, sometimes we need a second chance. One of the things I love that Jeff brought up at our strategic planning meeting on Thursday, he said, we are a house of second chances. We're a house of people who have lived imperfect lives but worship a perfect God. And the more we get to know him, the more we become like him in the process. Amen? But 1111, John 1111 is where I want to begin today. Because I want to tell you, God is releasing multiplication, not just addition. God is releasing, say it with me, when I give, it's not a subtraction, it's multiplication. But what you were happy with in times past in terms of addition, God is going to release by multiplication in this season. See, because most of the time when we see a number like 22, 11 plus 11, we're like, King of David, bless God. But then there's times when it's 121 because you don't even know what you're opening most times with the key. How many of you get excited about keys? When keys get talked about, you're a prophetic church. Everybody loves the keys. But what have you done with your keys lately? What are we doing with our key? Are we opening a door? Are we opening a door? You know, this one of the first shows that Morningstar filmed with us aired this past week, and it starts off by sharing this vision that God had given us when we first came to Birmingham on 12-12-12, December 12, 2012, about these escrow accounts that were opened between the year 1983 and 1988. That there was a season of prophetic grace that was partnered with First Season, but discouragement, disappointment, and division in the body had got in that brought a delay. Not a detour, but a delay to what God wanted to do. But those escrow accounts are about to be re-released with interest. And listen, heaven has great interest rates, better than any CD. Escrow accounts be re-released with interest, keys being given, doors being opened, and promises being occupied. And so if you have a key, it's for a door. Or if you have a key, it's to get that vehicle, that instrument started. And for those of you here a couple weeks ago, I talked about the replacement car that we had gotten was a Nissan Rogue. And, of course, a Rogue is somebody who does something in an unconventional way. That's us. Out of the norm. I love Steve found that definition. But then also, Rogue as a verb means to remove the inferior or defective plants from a crop. It's a harvest implementation that removes the tare from your wheat. And so the Lord was saying, yeah, you took a shot to your headlight and to your fender, and headlight speaks of illumination, is my left side, which speaks of ministry. He said, but not only am I going to restore it better than it was, and it already is, and it's getting ready to go back in tomorrow to get some finishing touches on them. Them saying, and this is what they said when I pulled it, they said, we can't even let you leave in this. We got to do some more to it. Because they saw streaks, things that most people would have said, oh, that's okay. Because, see, listen, when you're in the moment of favor, you don't settle for good. You go for God. See, most people would have said, hey, listen, that's really okay. And, you know, I don't want to inconvenience you. I was like, I think you're onto something. And so the more stuff she saw, I was like, did you see back here? Because there's a little smudge. And so all of a sudden that apostolic grace kicked in. My head thing, we missed a spot. And she's like, we can't let you leave with it. I said, well, I need it tonight to go on this trip. And they said, we'll bring it back on Monday and we'll take care of it. And they said, we want this to be the best it can be for you. And I want to tell you, that is a word to you. The vehicle and the ministry that God has prepared for you, he wants it to be his best, not your best. In other words, what I'm saying is he doesn't want you to limit it, like I told Mick and Marcia, to just what was good enough in times past. We're called to raise the ceiling of our expectancy. We're called to dream bigger. We're called to believe greater. And we're called to speak it into existence, which I'm going to talk more about at the 11 o'clock. But 121, I was like, wow, that's amazing. So God, what is it that you're actually tagging we collectively as a vehicle? Because how many know sometimes God will give a word to a leader if it's for an entire house? And so every word that I get, whether it's from someone that the Lord is speaking to me or someone that God sends with a word, I know it's not just about me, it's about us. And so I saw that in the window and I said, wow, God is giving us a vehicle and a door of awakening. See, revival is for us, but awakening is for the world. And how many of you know the church must be revived, but the nation must be awakened? Alabama must be awakened. Birmingham, Irondale, Moody. Listen, that Shikababa. I won't even say about that. How does somebody name a city Moody? Come on, who wants to live in a state of depression? Bam. I live in Trustville. Bam. Trust God. No, I'm just kidding. If you live in Moody, grace, grace. Hallelujah. I poke, I kid. John 11, verse 11. All right, is it on the screen? John 11, 11. Actually, let's back on up. Verse 1. We got 4 minutes. We can do this. You guys good? Listen, I'm telling you, my heart's so full today, I have no idea what's going to come out at the 11 o'clock. It's going to be amazing. Oh, 11. 11. Bam. Oh, interesting. Light just went off for me. It was on Highway 11 that I got hit. On Gadsden Highway. Thankfully, right in front of the Bojangles. Whew, Jesus. Because he said, are you okay? I said, I will be after a biscuit. And where was I going? I was actually going. Scott McCain had sent me some stuff, some info that I needed to get for my pool. Why? Because I was called to make the, we had sediments in the pool that weren't being filtered out that I needed to add a chemical to because there was a catalytic reaction that would bring a purity to the pool. And see, I was on my way to make the pool, Pool of Bethesda, pure and clean so that it could be enjoyed by the family as a whole. And what happened was there was an individual in front of me who had gotten over into a turn lane, had complete opportunity to go where he needed to go, and his inability to make the turn and his disregard for me caused him to try to get in my lane without signaling and then took that thing right off. But how do you know? All things work together for good. And this is what Mary and Martha and Lazarus found out in John chapter 11 is that even when it looks like death, God has already pre-appointed life. Amen? And so if you're in a situation that looks dark, if you're in a situation that looks like death, I want to tell you light and life is about to not just come to you, but it's about to come through you. Amen? John chapter 11 verse 1. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. And there's a lot of prophetic nuggets in here that we don't have time to unpack in the next 2 minutes. So I'm going to get through a couple verses just to hit a couple highlights of what I believe the door we're called to turn and open up in this season is, not just for us, but for our nation as a whole. Verse 2, it was the Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. What is highlighted here? Her worship. Her worship positioned her and her family not just for a visitation, but for a resurrection. And I want to tell you, the worship of this house is like the fragrant offering of Mary. Whoa, it just hit me again. About to send D money for my other claim check. What was the other name that was on the check? Mary. Oh, man, I love it when God puts the pieces together. I'm in the midst of this revelation with you right now. Lights are getting turned on. Therefore, the sisters sent to him saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. So they didn't appeal to his power. They appealed to his heart. They appealed to his love. They said, listen, we're calling on your compassion. The one who you love is sick. The one who you love is lost. The one who you love is addicted. If we'll begin to start seeing our city in this way, the one who you love has believed a lie, God will give us more than enough to resurrect them out of a place of hopelessness and bring them into a place of great hope. But it was her worship that positioned her. Not just her, but her whole house. How many Marys in this place? See, her worship highlighted her house. Individual worship highlighted a corporate visitation, a personal resurrection, but one person's willingness to give it all drew and attracted the heart of heaven to where heaven came when heaven needed to come. When Jesus heard that, he said, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it." How many of you like that? You're going through something. It looks bad. And the Lord's like, "It's all right. It's going to be all right. This ain't about what the devil's trying to take from you. It's about what I'm trying to get to you. This isn't about what can be lost or can be stolen. This is about God is going to be glorified in your midst if you can stay in a place of worship." Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he had heard that they were sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. I love Jesus. He gets the hospital call. So-and-so is sick. They're near death. We need you to come. He's like, "I'll see you in 2 more days. How many of you know, most people would have left Jesus' church. Because they want the pastor or a pacifier and not the person of Jesus. I don't want a good prayer. I want the glory of God. Amen. So when he heard he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. He said, "I'm going to let him be real good and dead." Because listen, some of y'all are believing for a healing when really you need to believe for a resurrection. And your family, God's not just wanting to bring a healing of what was. He's wanting to bring the resurrection that brings restoration, that releases redemption and reconciliation. Goes on in verse 7. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, lately the Jews sought to stone you, and you're going there again." In other words, you're walking across enemy lines. Jesus answered and said, "Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world." In other words, Jesus was saying, "What they want, baby, I got it. But if one walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him." Here's where we're going, verse 11. It's amazing. The first Sunday I ever pastored in Birmingham was 11/11/2012. And I know the Lord is saying that what he appointed for that time, we're about to experience now. A season, and I remember when we first came, our heart was flooded with revelation of redemption for this city. And in the midst of that revelation and God promising things he would do and inviting us to pick up batons that had been set down, in the midst of that, sometimes stuff happens. Anybody know stuff happens? And a lot of times stuff happens through people, bless their hearts. But oftentimes people begin to try to discourage you in what you're called to do. One of the ways to know you're called is if somebody else tries to disqualify you. If someone tries to bring a lie into your life that would cause you to believe you could be disqualified, discredited, or displaced. Because I want to tell you, like the Lord told me, you didn't choose him, he chose you. And he chose you to be in this place for such a time as this, that you would bear fruit and that fruit would remain. You are chosen by God for this hour and its time. You are chosen by God for this city, and now is the day. 11:11. These things he said, and after that he said to them, "Our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up." It's awakening. Then his disciples said, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get well." However, Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought that he was speaking about taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus said to them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, boys. He's dead. And I'm glad." What? He's dead and I'm glad. See, sometimes you got to let things get good and dead before God will resurrect it. And see, honestly, our unsanctified mercy, which is not a gift of the Spirit, unsanctified mercy, delivering people out of a God-ordained fire. Anybody ever seen somebody in a problem and you want to be their deliverer? You want to stop their hurt. You say, "I wonder what I can do to help this person out," instead of get behind them and say, "Just keep going." Because if you're in the valley of the shadow of death, the last thing you need to do is camp out. You need to keep going, because on the other side of that valley, bless God, there's a table prepared. And so you need people in your life that don't try to talk you into quitting the fire, but get behind you and say, don't quit. There's a table on the other side of the valley. And so he said, listen, I'm glad he's dead for your sakes. He said, I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, that you may. How do we limit God? And what we believe, what we see, and what we say. Nevertheless, let us go to him. Then Thomas, good old Thomas, give me your Thomas, who is called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Poor old Thomas. And listen, oftentimes when we look at what we're saying, the enemy tries to swing us into two ditches. One is doubt, which is where Thomas lived, and the other is denial. And see, denial, it said that this of Abraham, it said he spoke to things that did not exist as though they did. He spoke to things that weren't as though they were. He did not deny the problem. And see, oftentimes when we look at the voice of faith, we actually deny the problem instead of attaching the promise to the problem and saying the promise is greater than the problem. Because being a man or woman of faith is not to say that you have no problems. It's just saying that what the Word of God says as it relates to my problem is bigger than the problem I face. And I'm going to speak from this place and not from a reflection of what I see in the natural. But you have people who either get in doubt or denial, denying what is and therefore never speaking to things that are not as though they are, or you have people who are in doubt and say, what's the point? We'll go die with him. But we're not called to be either of those, are we? Verse 17, so when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Why is that important? Because Jewish belief was that a man's spirit, a woman's spirit, would leave the body after the third day. And so what he was saying was, he was like, I'm not just coming to bring a healing. I'm not just coming to give a little mouth to mouth. I'm not just coming to resuscitate. I'm coming to resurrect. Because there is power to create in what we communicate. Say that. Say there's power to create in what I communicate. The power of life and death are in the tongue. Amen. We're going to talk more about that at 11. But it goes on. It says, so when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away. And many of the Jews had joined the women around Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Oh, you poor dear. I can't believe you're going through this. If the Lord had only come sooner. Can you believe the nerve of that Jesus? I mean, you called him, didn't you? You gave him the room number, didn't you? No flowers, no pizza, no gift card. No, nothing. Listen, some of the people in your life that may be trying to speak comfort to your heart are actually trying to keep you in a place that's comfortable that you were never called to be in the first place. Because you'll never walk on the water unless you get out of the boat. They were probably related to the professional mourners in Mark chapter 5 that were weeping on behalf of Jairus' daughter. How do you know? Some people just like to be sad. Some people are so unhappy with their life, they'll actually take a tragedy in someone else's life and attach their gossip to that tragedy because they have nothing in their life to be happy about. Moody. Come on. If you don't believe me, check out your newsfeed. I'm cranked up for the 11, just so you know. And many of the Jews joined women around Martha and Mary. I'm going to talk about how to handle the nation, all the bathroom stuff. We're going everywhere at the 11 o'clock. Might have to order lunch. Martha, as soon as she had heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary was sitting in the house. Why? She had given up hope. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. See, Martha, it was the voice of doubt that spoke. Mary was in a place of rest. She was in a place of trust because her worship of who he was greater than their knowledge of what he did. And see, your worship cannot be connected to what he does. It has to be connected to who he is. Her worship of who he was greater than the secondhand knowledge that Martha had of what Jesus could do. Amen? Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. If you had answered when I called, if you had come to the hospital, if you had done this, this, and this. But even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. He'll rise again. When? What does that look like? How are you get that word from God and what he's about to do, but then you're like, what now? What do we do while we wait? That's called faith. Because once you have a word, that word has to be planted in you until you're planted in that word. And see, some of the waiting game isn't because God is trying to withhold a good thing. He's wanting you to become rooted in the promise that God has already given you. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am. I am. I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me. There it is again, that belief. Though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? How do we limit God in what we believe, what we see, and what we say? He was trying to attach her faith. He was trying to attach her heart conviction with who he really was and what he came to do. Do you believe? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you're the Christ, the Son of God, who's come to the world. In other words, she said, I believe in who you are. I just don't know if I can believe in what you've said you would do. How many of you have found yourself in that place? You can believe in who Jesus is. But man, sometimes you start to doubt. Did God say, will God do? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Verse 28, and when she had said these things, she went her way and secretly called Mary, her sister, saying, the teacher has come and is calling for you. Which he didn't do. She was just saying, well, maybe she'll have better luck. As soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came to him. Now, Jesus had not yet come into the town, but he was in the place where Martha met him. Then the Jews who were with her in the house and comforting her, when they saw that Mary rose up quickly and went out, they followed her, saying, she's going to the tomb to weep there. They were giving a false prophecy. See, there's people who would like to attach their doubt to your life. They, based on their perception, were trying to prophesy her into a place that she was not meant to be. See, not everything that sounds like God is God. I'm just going to leave that there. Jesus had not yet come into the town. Verse 31. Then the Jews who were with her in the house, comforting her, when they said that Mary rose up quickly and went out, followed her, saying, she is going to the tomb to weep there. Let us go with her. Listen, if you got people in your life that listening to it makes you tired, you may want to do most of the talking in that relationship. I was talking to somebody the other day. They're like, yeah, I'm just so tired. I was like, really, why? Let's talk about it. They're like, oh, well, you know. Because a lot of times what happens is there's no real substance to the lie, but how many of you know if you believe the lie, you become tired? Because he came to steal, kill, and destroy. He said, if we do not become weary in well doing, we will reap. See, if the enemy can cause you to become weary in doing good, he knows he can abort your harvest. And that's why the attack against your heart is actually an attack against your harvest. As soon as she heard that, let's jump down to verse 33. I keep trying to go back up. Therefore, when Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews came with her weeping, he groaned in the spirit, was troubled, and he said, where have you laid him? In other words, it's about to get on. I like when Jesus is just all about business. There's times when he's teaching, and then he's times when he's doing. Amen? And he's about to do something. He said, where have you laid him? And they said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. In other words, Jesus was moved. His heart was broken. Because the hearts of those that he loved were broken. And see, what breaks your heart breaks his heart. But I'm telling you, God is wanting to bring resurrection to those things that look lost. Verse 36, and the Jews said, "See how he loved him." And some of them said, "Could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind also have kept this man from dying?" They're trying to find fault even in the man's tears. Then Jesus, again groaning in himself, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Verse 39, Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Why? Because he had to remove the limit off of Lazarus. Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, "Lord, by this time there is a stench, for he stinketh. For he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God?" And man, I love it when Holy Spirit just takes us off script. I hadn't read this morning, but the three things are in one verse right here. Did you see that? What you believe, what you see, and what you say. The Lord knows where he wants to take us. And see, sometimes we can be so committed to what we feel like we need to say, we don't get to hear the voice of God himself. Verse 40, Jesus said to her, "Did I not say, if you would believe, you would see the glory of God?" The reason why the Lord is recalibrating what we believe, what we see, and what we say is because the glory of God is about to be manifest in a new way. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying, and Jesus lifted up his head and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me." And everyone in here that has Jesus living in your heart, everyone here that has given their life, that he is your Lord, you have this confidence that as you pray, 1 John 5 tells us, according to his will, he hears you. And so Jesus was saying, "Listen, Father, I thank you that you hear me, and I'm doing this for them so that they can see you had a plan in the first place. Father, I thank you that you've heard me, and I know that you always hear me, but because of this people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me." Anybody ever said something for people who are around? That's what Jesus did. He's like, "Listen, I'm teaching you guys." Now, verse 43 says, "Now when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, 'Lazarus, come forth!' And he who died came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, 'Loose him and let him go.'" Stand up. "Wanda, come forth! Mike, come forth! Richard, come forth! Cindy, come forth!" I'm telling you, the Lord is speaking. Birmingham, come forth. Alabama, come forth. I'm removing the tomb, the stone. I'm rolling away the reproach. I'm forgiving the iniquity of times past. I no longer see you as an instrument of division, but Alabama, I see you as an instrument of unity in my nation. Bo, come forth. The days of embracing yesterday's death are gone. The days of entering into now life, now faith, now joy, now hope, now peace are here. Steve Roberts, come forth. Jill, come forth. Marcia, come forth. Johnny, hope, come forth. Julie, come forth. I'm telling you, heaven is waiting on us. We're not waiting on heaven. Will we get up and quit our mourning and recognize the one we've longed for is in our midst? He's in the house. He's in the city. He's in the state. He's still ruling over this nation. Renee, come forth. James, come forth. Joe! I'm telling you, the lion-like nature of God is here. Shelly, come forth. Matt, come forth. John and Joellen, come forth. And I believe we have a literal call to come forth. And so right now, if you've been in that place of sitting, weeping, If you've been in that place looking at what you lost or resting in your burial clothes, I want you to get out of your seat and come down right now, because the Holy Spirit's about to loose you. He's about to loose you because the Lord has need of you. He's about to say, loose and let him go. I'm telling you, there's such a breakout available today. He said, if you would believe, you would see. And if you would see, you would say. And if you said, they would see. And there's going to be a corporate manifestation of the loosing of the Lord in this house. Jesus. Jesus. Everybody come closer, because I'm going to ask those back there to come up and to form a rear guard around these here. And here's what I'm going to want those who are up here to do. You're going to pray for the person to your left and to your right the way that you wish somebody would pray for you. And we're going to declare over them today, loose them and let them go. Loose my brother, loose my sister, loose my father, loose my mother, loose my son, loose my daughter. Come on, all over this place right now. Loose. Loose. Loose them and let them go. Loose them and let them go. Loose them and let them go. Loose them and let them go right now. In the name of Jesus, I speak to the lies of darkness right now. In Jesus' name, loose. Ashton.
Yes.
I want you to pray. Just whatever you've got. Come on.
Jesus, we pray for the loosing. We pray for the releasing of your sons and your daughters, the ones that have been in tombs for way too long. We call them forth. But we pray that your presence would invade this place. We pray that they would go and they would do exactly what you called them to do. Not what people told them they were supposed to do, but what you said they were supposed to do. Jesus, we pray for the blank check that you have put in this place. And you tell them, fill them up. Fill that blank check up.
Come on, you're coming out of retirement. Come on, you're coming into retirement, John.
Loose them. Loose them and let them go. Loose them and let them go. Loose them and let them go.
Release that dynamic. Release that dunamis right now. Release that dynamic. Release that dunamis right now. Loose. In Jesus' name, loose. Loose right now. Father, we thank you for the releasing of destiny. And Lord, what has been stalled in times past, where the enemy has tried to thwart the plans of the Lord in this legacy right now, Father, we unclog and we fully plumb the piping of the Lord in Kyle's life. And I declare in the name of Jesus, you are a mighty warrior. You are a valiant warrior in the hand of the Lord, in the army of God. Father, thank you, Lord. Thank you for men and women of integrity and substance. Loose. 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 Loose them and let them go. Richard, come forth. Solara, come forth. Come forth. Jeff, whatever you got in your heart. Band, I need you, band. Chris Brown, Robbers Boys, come. Come on, come on. Come on, come on. Come on, run, don't walk. Come, come, loose, 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 loose. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we tap into the power and to the presence. Lord, we appeal to you and your love and your heart for our city. Look upon the city that you love. Look upon the people that you've dreamed for and dreamed about. Loose. 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 Father, I thank you for what you're doing in the family. But Lord, now we say more. We're thankful, but more. Nothing less than whole house. Mike, come here. Nothing, Mike, Micah Bell, come on. Nothing less than whole house salvation. Nothing less than whole house kingdom. In Jesus' name, we declare Joshua 24:15 over you and over your house. As for you and your house, they will all serve the Lord. Come on. Jesus, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, begin to pray for one another. Loose them and let them go. Loose them and let them go. Shakara Bahata.